Couple of weeks ago, I passed the Databricks exam. In today's short video, I want to share with you some of my experiences and tips on how to pass this exam. And if you're new to my channel, I'm Riz Ang and I built a data platform. First thing first, why would you take the Databricks exam? Well, if you are a developer or working as a data engineer or data scientist, you might have come across a lot of certifications out there, whether it is Microsoft certifications, AWS certifications, or Google Cloud certifications. And Databricks, which is basically a curated Apache Spark, also provides a number of certifications that you can take. Now, the goal of taking these certifications is generally to make you more marketable. Marketable in the sense that if you're working in a job, if you have some of these certifications, it gives you an edge over your coworkers. And if you're a consultant like me, when we are about to provide the service to our client will love us a lot more if they know that we are certified. And of course, you can put this certification on your LinkedIn profile so that the world knows that you are certified and you know this product or service. All right, first thing first, the exam that I took was the Databricks Certified Associate Developer for Spark 3.0, which is the latest version, and I did it in Python. If you want, you can take it in Scala as well. And I think there's also another certification, the Professional Data Scientist exam. And that is available. And there is another one coming soon that's not available yet, which is the Professional Data Engineer Databricks certification. I believe it should come sometime this year. The exam has 60 multiple choice questions and you have 2 hours to do it. And you can take start the exam 10 minutes before the scheduled time. You need 70% to pass, i.e. you need 42 questions answered correctly of 60. All right, now onto my tips on this. First of all, it's more about before the exam. So my first tip is if you work for a company that can pay for training with Databricks, I would suggest you do that because it will help you a lot, meaning you get a Databricks instructor who can guide you in your architecture as well as the practical questions that you may have while you're actually coding Spark. Now, I myself took a training, I believe it's called Databricks cohort training, which is really helpful for me. And there were also some self-service training as well that I did, which was again useful for my preparation. If you can't afford, or if for some reason you can't get training, read books. The book that helped me a lot is this Learning Spark, chapter 1, 3 to 7 are the ones that you want to focus on. And there's another one called Beginning Apache Spark with Databricks. And for both books, I will share you the link in the description below for you to check it out. Okay. And also, if you want, you can also test Databricks with Databricks Community Edition, which again, I will link the link down below in the description. Okay. My third tip is to familiarize yourself with the Spark documentation. The reason is because you actually get this documentation during the exam. So you can actually read this documentation to help you pass the exam. The problem is it's not as intuitive as Googling. So you cannot, there's no search button where you basically want to search what functions does what. So you actually get a PDF file, and I suggest you familiarize yourself with the Spark documentation, and I'll share with you the documentation in the link down below in my description again. My tip number 4 is this exam is online proctoring, meaning there will be actually no one that will monitor you or wait or sit with you, making sure you're not doing anything that you're not supposed to do. But you basically have to stay in front of your laptop or computer with the camera on all the time. If you need to go to the bathroom, please do it before the exam, because for 2 hours, you basically can't do that. You have to stay in front of your laptop for 2 hours. Now also, for some reason, because of the online proctoring, the moment you start the exam, you will only be able to work with your main screen. And in my case, I have a laptop and extended monitor, and for some reason, I just can't use my extended monitor. So I just end up with my main screen, my laptop, which is quite tiny. Unfortunately, I don't like it, but I had to live with it. And again, coming back to my point number three, the Spark documentation is not, you have to scroll down a lot. And because this is in my laptop and the exam screen has the questions in it and also the Spark documentation on the side, it's very small to actually read the Spark documentation. So it's a bit useless really, the documentation, if you get what I mean. Now my next tip is make sure you familiarize with the Spark architecture. This is crucial. You will get a lot of questions about this. And what I mean by architecture is how Spark engine works. And you have to understand what's the concept around the cluster, what's underneath the cluster, the driver and the worker concept, what are the nodes, whether the driver node or the worker nodes work, and within each node there's an executor, which is like a space where the task gets done, and also a core or slot or thread, what it's called, where this is basically the machine that does the job. Now there's also application that is broken down by jobs, a job broken down by stages, and stage broken down into tasks. Just make sure you understand all this, because you get a question about it. Make sure you understand what's the difference between narrow versus wide transformation. And there is such a thing called action versus transformation. Make sure you check that out, because it will be asked. Just for information, transformation is lazy, nothing is actually done or action with transformation, whereas action is where data get actually read and processed, transformed and written, etc. You need to make sure you understand these differences. Shuffling, where data gets shuffled across different nodes. Repartition, qualas, is again different way to change the partition, so the data within the partition itself, bucketing, and garbage collection. I think the garbage collection may not come up, but I think it's in scope, so make sure you're aware of what that is. The next one is obviously data frame. Make sure you understand well what data frame is, use it, code it, make sure you test it, how to read and write from different file formats, from CSV, JSON, Parquet file, or even Delta, and how to write a schema or get a schema out of your data frame, printing it, creating a temporary local view, and also caching or persisting your data frame. And also make sure you understand the difference between caching and persisting. All of this is only a click of a button from Google or Spark documentation. But if you want to know more about it, feel free to ask me in the link down below. I'm happy to try to answer it. My last tip about understanding the exam content, or make sure you prepare for the exam, is make sure you practice all of these Spark functions. Now, this is not all of them, but this is probably some of the common ones that I use or I tried myself. So again, I mentioned about action, which is basically what gets action by Spark engine. So things like collect, count, first, head, take, and show. Get familiarized on what these are. Different type of kind of transformations, distinct, drop duplicates, filtering, so on and so forth, until where. Untyped transformations, aggregate, apply, and all these transformations, make sure you're aware what these are and how you use it. It's more about how you use it, because in the exam, you actually get questions about there's a scenario to do something, and you get to you have to evaluate the PySpark or the Spark code that's been written, and you need to make sure you understand, and to understand that well, you need to code it, you need to type it yourself. Joins, it's pretty straightforward, left, inner, right join. Aggregate functions, again, counting, approximate count, distinct, even all the way to variance and standard deviation. Exploding, explode, a collection, registering, user-defined function, date and time function, so on, you know, Unix timestamp, non-aggregate function like column, or literal, or lit, sorting functions, and string functions as well. This is sort of a list of things that I had, and I need to make sure that I tried every single one of these before the exam and familiarized with them, and that helped me a great deal to pass the exam. At the end of the exam, after you submit your results, you will get your unofficial outcome immediately, whether you pass or you fail. When you pass, congratulations. You will get within usually 3 to 5 days an email from Databricks that you've now achieved the Databricks certification, and they'll give you a badge, something like this one. That's all for today's video. I hope it's useful. Like or subscribe to my channel if you find or if you like content like this. And that's it. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.